Hello everyone. Obviously, I had to make another post with regards to the events that are happening right now in Israel. But apart from that, I want to also briefly flash back to the previous posts. I posted a few weeks ago an alert called Eyes on Damascus, and in the shadow of all the other events, the things in Damascus are still going on. The tension between the US and Russia is increasing, and also other parties are on the scene, like Iran and China, and some others. But in particular, those that will play a major role in the future in that other war called the Gog-Magog War, which I posted also about after that. So these things are still developing, and it is absolutely something to keep an eye on. It is so that on the 5th of December, the EU and Israel signed a deal for delivering natural gas from Israel straight into Europe. And that is, of course, a major threat economically to Russia, which is the largest gas exporter in the world and is delivering a lot of their gas to Europe. And so that is one of the motivations for that future war. That is exactly what the Bible describes. Also, I mentioned in the post about that war that Turkey would be one of the players, one of the allies of Russia and Iran in particular. And that may seem strange because Turkey is a NATO member. But as I mentioned, they are separating from NATO, and this is also becoming stronger and stronger, and even more so with the recent developments with regards to Jerusalem. Turkey has taken a clear position in that and separates itself with that politically more and more from NATO and from the West in general. Now, the main topic, of course, is Jerusalem. We have seen on the 6th of December that President Trump has recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, and that turned almost all the world upside down. Which, if you really think of it, is very weird, because historically, Jerusalem has been the capital of Israel for thousands of years. There is nothing strange to recognize that. The problem is, of course, the fear of not being able to broker a peace deal because of this. And it is only this fear that drives all the others almost to madness. Which I think is actually ungrounded, because they have not been able to get a peace deal on the table without this status of Jerusalem. So why would it be any different now? But I think that was also the gist of President Trump's motivation. But it is crazy to see that the United Nations, 151 countries, voted on a statement that Israel or the Jewish people have no ties to Jerusalem. Well, this is really incredible. There is so much written proof, there is so much archaeological evidence. It's just crazy. But this is the world we live in. Everything is upside down. As a result of that, violence has broken out, and this will probably continue for quite a while. And also, as I fear, it will spread to the West with terror attacks. and most likely in particular in the United States, but not exclusively. The Arab League has also convened after that. This was last weekend, and they, 22 countries, they request the United States to reverse this this statement. Again, they say it is a violation of international justice. How they get to that, I do not know, but that is that's what they say. With this, and this has been said a lot already on the internet in many commentaries, with that we see Zechariah 12 getting more and more fulfilled, and although it was already, we were already in that season, but it says there in verse 2 and 3, it says, "Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all the people round about." Now, the I is God. Obviously, God will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling. So it's God's hand actually behind it. God is in control of all this. And what is happening is simply fulfillment of that which has been written long ago. And but this was hundreds of years before Christ. But what it says here is, "I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all the people round about." So these are the nations surrounding Israel. And that is interesting, because that is actually what we see. It are those countries, Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Iran, Egypt, those that are near to Israel, that are in the Middle East. And this is in line with what we can also read in Psalm 83. Not gonna dissect the whole psalm there, but just a few verses. It says in verse 4, Psalm 83, "They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel be no more in remembrance. For they have consulted together with one consent. They are confederate against thee." And this is what you see. The nations are, the different nations that are in strife with each other for all kinds of reasons, but they are one, they are consulting together against Israel. And then it mentions in verse 6 the tabernacles of Edom and the Ishmaelites. The tabernacles of Edom, there's a whole analysis behind it, but you can trace that basically back to the Palestinians in particular. So it's not one ethnic group. But it is the spirit of Edom, or Esau, as it is in the Bible. Esau, who was the brother of Jacob. Jacob, who was Israel. It were Jacob's 12 sons who formed the 12 tribes of Israel. And already in the womb of Rebekah, these two, Esau and Jacob, were struggling. And God declared that was a sign of what they would be. Two peoples, two nations that would be in strife, and this is so until today. So here it speaks about the tabernacles of Edom. It is the so-called Palestinians that are against Israel, and the Ishmaelites. And Ishmaelites are the descendants of Ishmael, which was of course the brother of Isaac, the two sons of Abraham. And so Ishmael had 12 sons also, who became leaders of 12 tribes, one of which is the tribe Kedar, from which Mohammed came. So the Ishmaelites, you can say, are the Muslims at large. So we have the Palestinians in particular, and we have the Muslim world at large that are against, together against Israel. And then it continues to mention all kinds of other tribes with their ancient names. So, but if you analyze that, you can see that these are all areas in what today is Jordan, Egypt, Lebanon, and Syria. So indeed, as Zechariah mentions, those nations that are round about Israel. But in Zechariah 12, verse 3, it says then, "And in that day I will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it." So that's quite a statement to make 600 years before Christ, that all the nations of the world would burden themselves with this one city that is not even such a large city, this one city in Israel called Jerusalem. And that's exactly what we see today. So really profound, and it shows once again where we are on the prophetic timeline. Now, one thing I want to mention, this summer I posted a video with a message with regards to the solar eclipse that was on August the 21st. The solar eclipse that went from the west to the east coast of the United States. And interestingly enough, the shadow of the moon, because that's what the solar eclipse is, the shadow of the moon passed over seven cities in different states from west to east coast. Seven cities with the name Salem. And I mentioned back then that this name Salem is actually from the word Shalom, which means peace. And it is the same name that Jerusalem used to have, which you can find in scripture even in the time of Abraham already. When he first came in that area, he met there the priest Melchizedek, and it says he was the king of Salem. And later on we find in the Psalms that David put up the tabernacle there at Salem. And then in King David's time it was renamed to Jerusalem. But Salem points to Jerusalem, and I alluded to this in August, that eclipses, solar and moon eclipses, usually are signs or harbingers of something to come. When it is a solar eclipse, it's a harbinger for the nations. When it is a moon eclipse, it's a harbinger for Israel. We can see that also in the calendars. The Israel or the biblical calendar is based on the moon, whereas the Western calendar, the Gregorian calendar, is based on the sun. So I alluded to this, that this could mean something, some connection between the United States, because that's where the eclipse was, and Jerusalem. I think that has been fulfilled. That is shown to be true. The second thing I alluded to is that the word Salem means peace. It were seven cities that were in this shadow of the moon. Seven being the number of God. I explained all this that in this video. We'll not go into this now, but it might show that the shadow of the moon pointing to Israel, as the biblical calendar being based on the moon, the shadow of the moon, or the shadow of Israel, you could say, or the shadow of the decision made about Israel, will go and cover Salem, cover peace. It will take away the peace. And another side note you could make is that the moon is also the symbol of Islam. It is found on top of every mosque. So you could also explain it maybe that way, that it is Islam that will take away peace. So it might very well be that this eclipse was actually a harbinger of things to come that we see coming to pass right now. In any case, I think it's good to keep our eyes on what's happening, particularly in Israel. That is what Jesus instructed us to do. He said, look at the fig tree, and the fig tree is a symbol of Israel in the Bible. So that's what we do. We keep our eyes on Damascus because we know that there is a prophecy to be fulfilled, particularly mentioned in Isaiah chapter 17 and Amos chapter 1, and also in Jeremiah 49. At the same time, we see indeed that peace seems to be taken away. And so we find peace only in one place, and that is with Jesus. His name, Yeshua, means safety or salvation. That is where we need to turn to. And yeah, let's keep also in our prayers the people that live in California that is being devastated with these fires. And yeah, let's, as I end every post so far, let's lift up our heads because our redemption draws near.